Hello, Matthew.
Hello.
I wanted to ask you, what sort of first drew you to the role of Uncle Charlie in Stoker?
Not being facetious, but my good friend Colin Firth was meant to be doing the role, and his schedule became untenable. So he pulled out, and he was super gracious. He was like, I obviously would love to be doing this, but he was kind of, but I'm glad it's you, which is lovely. But I wasn't offered, you know. I had to go through that. I had to jump through hoops, quite rightly. It was pretty competitive. I think it was just one of those cases of, like, you know, it was a similar bunch of actors of my age group that I've known for many years and I respect. And it's, you know, it's the same kind of names in the hat. And luckily mine was the last out on this occasion, you know. On other occasions it's been other friends of mine. But also the script is amazing.
True.
The script was amazing, and obviously it was director Park, and Nicole was attached already, and Mia was attached, and I was like, wow, what a tremendous bunch of actors, and Jackie Weaver, so it's kind of a no-brainer, really.
Were you, like, a big director Park fan before taking on the project?
I was a paying member of the public to go and watch Old Boy. Years ago, I went and watched it with my ex-girlfriend, Margot. So it was a weird date night movie to go on.
I'm pretty sure we
went to go and watch another movie, and then I kicked my heels and said, I don't want to go and watch romantic comedy, I want to watch Old Boy. And she was like, fine. And I thoroughly enjoy it. You know, that's one of the things I was so excited about, is that he puts a film together. Amazing camera work, but I didn't realise until I obviously met him that in pre-production and rehearsal, just his fastidious nature, just how detailed everything was, you know, and every frame of the film had already pre-drawn, which in some ways was slightly disconcerting, because you're like, how much room do I have for manoeuvre here, you know? And actually, he's super collaborative, and really, you know, some of the stuff that's in the movie was stuff that were ideas we came up with either in rehearsal or just spare of the moment, and which is a real testament to him that he's able to come outside of this vision. He has 90% of the film made in his head already. I was like, so we only bring 10% of it? He's like, yeah.
I love that scene when the sheriff comes to interrogate you and you're standing by the wall and it's not to be a mirror and you walk forward. It's so amazing. You don't necessarily always see that sort of, like, you know, auteur stamp on, you know, a thriller or like a horror film or something.
Yeah, and it's all pre-planned, you know, that's the thing.
I'm sure.
He's gotten to the space, and actually I think that one, he went into the space and they thought that is a really nice way of shooting it. And then just have me, I mean, I'm in there, but I'm that thing of where you're out of focus, and then to sort of ramp it up. By that point, we realised this is not a whodunit, you know. We've seen some pretty interesting stuff already by that point, but the way he walks forward, Uncle Charlie walks forward, or the way I walked forward, you kind of think, Christ, is he going to do away with him now? And then it's sort of like the smile comes along, and it's like it becomes this other thing.
Yeah.
It's always sort of turning things on their heads of what you kind of expect to happen.
Yeah, it's just so funny because you think that he's like kind of like surreptitiously listening to them, and then you realize he's watching them, and you're like, oh God, like, what's he going to do?
I know. Oh God, what's he going to do?
So frightening.
It's so true. You know, there is that. You know, and that's one of the big things. There is a very animalistic nature between my character and Mia's character. That there is the prey, who's the hunter, and you know, that kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
Because he's very, thematically, Director Park always talked about the idea of bad blood and whether there is a predisposition within the family bloodline to want and need to commit these acts. So we shared a lot more in nature than anything else, I think.
I thought you did a really good American accent.
Like, oh, thank you.
And how?
God for that.
But how did you sort of like prepare for that? Like, what are your sort of tricks of the trade that you use for accents?
Well, I've done it before, American, on a couple of occasions, and I was always slightly nerve-wracking, you know, because there's the element of I've taken a job away from an American actor. That's how I always feel. So you better get it right.
Yeah.
And I was a bit rusty, so I had Liz Hemelstein. Nicole had her voice coach there with her, and I utilised her, which is really nice. And I always think, the next time I want to have like a couple of months so that you walk on set first day and you're really super confident. But there's always time constraints and financial constraints to that. So next American film, I'm going to spend some more time. But I think it worked out pretty well, you know, and there was an element of he's sort of, because there's no geographical center to this film. I mean, we shot it in Tennessee, Nashville, but it's a gothic horror in some ways, but it's not placed. You don't know it's in the South. It's not actually set in the South. We don't know it at all where it is or what time frame it really is. So there was an element of that Charlie is slightly, he's like a man-child, he's slightly caught up in his past, and because there's no time frame, he seems to come from a slightly different era, so he's slightly more anglicized, I think, you know.
Yeah.
Like, if you listen to actors in the 1960s speak, it seems so incredibly, you know, almost posh American as opposed to how it is now. So that's kind of what we were aiming for.
I mean, there are a ton of American actors that can't do Boston accents or Southern accents.
But that's the thing, I think, America has, it's a vast place, it has as many differences in accent. I mean, England's hilarious because we're only 600 miles long, but you go to a different village just across the way and it's like, whoa, what just happened there? Because we had the Vikings invade us and we had this, and so there's places in Yorkshire where they have this sort of Scandinavian hangover from the Vikings where they can't, so the Isles come out grouting like that and you're like, what is that noise? It's amazing. So I find it fascinating, and like, you know, They are worth their weight in gold, great dialect coaches, and Liz is certainly one of those.
What was the most challenging aspect of working on Stoker?
Oh, working with Kidman, for Christ's sake. The most challenging aspect, I think, it was a lot of fun. I mean, it really was. I mean, I think that kind of happens occasionally on films that have a very slightly dastardly nature to them, then you kind of goof around a bit during when you're not doing takes. Not to say that we're not taking it seriously, we absolutely are, but you kind of need something cathartic to happen just to sort of get rid of it all. And so it was a lot of fun. I think there were some time constraints. We didn't have a huge amount of time, so some days were quite pressured. But it didn't lead to the work deteriorating at all, you know. And that was what was great about working with Nicole and Mia, is that you had to go in with your knowing your stuff. It wasn't, you can't muck about.
Great, well, thank you, Matthew.
Thank you very much. That's good, we bookended it with me not being able to speak because of coffee. Perfect.